Good morning, student. Today we are going to learn about Funaria, which is included in a Bryopsida. So these all are the diagrammatic representation. Funaria has its own life cycle, and this is the diagrammatic representation of a Funaria life cycle. This is the morphological representation of a single Funaria plant body or a thallus body. These are the rhizoids, and this one is the leaf. When we are taking a transverse section through the stem, that can show such type of structure, and this is the transverse section taken through a leaf. So this one is the leaf. Then for the purpose of propagation or reproduction, they have developed archegonium and anthridium. So this one is the archegonium and this one is the anthridium, and here is the complete developed capsule in a longitudinal section. So first of all, Funaria is a gametophyte. It bears sex organs and forms gamete. The most of life cycle of Funaria is a gametophyte. Here is the classification of a Funaria. Funaria is get divided, it get placed into a kingdom, that is a Plantae, because it has chlorophyll. Then get divided into a subkingdom, that is a Embryophyta, due to the development of embryo. Then divided into phylum or division, that is a Bryophyta. And the class, that is a Bryopsida, which is also called as a Mosses. And the subclass, that is a Bryidae. Order, Funerals, family Funaraceae, and the genus is Funaria. So how they are morphologically looking like? So that is nothing but anhabit and habitat. So total 117 species are found in overall world, from which 15 species are found in India. Funaria hygrometrica is a cosmopolitan species. It is also called as cod mosses, and they are specially found on walls. When we are looking for the external morphology, Funaria is a gametophyte which mainly has two stages, that are protonema and gametophore. Protonema is a ampharal, and it is creeps on ground, while gametophore is a persistent and erect. It is formed by the bud of protonema. It represents the main gametophyte of a Funaria, that is 1 to 3 centimeter in height. It has three parts, that is rhizoids, then axis, and third one, that is a leaf. So one by one, the rhizoids, that is a thin and hyaline branch with oblique septa, multicellular, helpful in the absorption of water and minerals. So as like a root, the rhizoids of a Funaria can hold substratum, can absorb water. They are having oblique septa. Rhizoids are developed by the many cells, that why multicellular in nature. But the axis is erect, which bears leaves which are arranged in a spiral manner. Sometimes it may be branches are extra axillary branches, and On that branches, there is a development of a leaves. These leaves are sessile, means without stalk. Simple, mean because they have a single leaf lamina, which is an entire. And the shape of the leaves is an ovate with one midrib. So, here is the complete external morphology of a Funaria. These are the rhizoids. This one is the axis, which is also called as a stem. And on that stem, here is the development of a leaves. And from that leaves, there is an emergence of a sporophyte. This one is the sporophyte, which has capsule and calyptra. And these are the enlarged diagram of a rhizoids, which has possessed oblique septa. This is the single leaf, which has single midrib, and these are the cells. When we are taking a transverse section through axis, which is also called as a stem, it has three parts, that is epidermis, cortex, and conducting strand. So this outermost limiting and protecting layer, that is called as a epidermis. And below that, here is the development of a parenchymatous cells called as a cortex. And at the center, here is the development of a central strand, which is a conducting strand. Conducting means they are conducting water and mineral and also the foods. This epidermis is a single layer cells with chloroplast and absence of a cuticle and stomata on them. While the cortex is multi-layered parenchymatous cells, central conducting strands has centrally located, having a parenchymatous cells, due to the absence of a protoplasm, helps in a conduction. Here is the most important thing to note down. The parenchymatous cells, just due to the absence of a protoplasm, all parenchymatous cells are living in nature and they have protoplasm. But while these central conducting tissues, which are rather different from the cortical parenchymatous cells, these cells are does not showing a protoplasm, and that's why they are taking part in the conduction as like a xylems. The leaf with central midrib, in which wings are found at the both side laterally. Middle part of the midrib contains conducting strand. So these are the wings, means these are the leaf lamina, and that each and every cell possesses a chloroplast. And at the center, there is a presence of a midrib region, which having again a parenchymatous cells but without a protoplast, that is called as a central strand. And the remaining cells, which are present at the periphery, they are just part of the main midrib. Growth. When we are coming towards the growth, it takes place by the single apical cell with three cutting faces. So, as like a meristem, here is the three cutting stage faces, which can always in a position to grow many more cells. Then come towards the reproduction. Reproduction occurs by two methods. First of all, vegetative, and second one, that is a sexual. So when vegetative reproduction occurs, that is by the following methods: primary protonema, then secondary protonema. They also develops gametes, and there is a development of a bulbil. So this is the main thallus of a Funaria. They are develops many more rhizoids, and on that rhizoids there is a development of a secondary protonema. That secondary protonema directly can develop into a new plant of a Funaria. Also, they have possesses bulbils, and that bulbils can be again developed into a new plant of a Funaria. Sometimes it has a buds and bulbils, they also get converted into a new plant of a Funaria. And the fifth type of a vegetative reproduction is a apospory. The development of a gametophyte without formation of a spores by a sporophyte, that is called as a apospory. Beside this, rhizoids before their death of unfavorable seasons form tubers which germinate and develops into new plant in the favorable condition. Then come towards the sexual type of reproduction. Within this reproduction, gametophores are developed. So gametophores are two types, monoecious or autoecious, and second one, that is Anthridium and Archegonium. These are situated on different branches of a same plant. Then there is another type of sexual reproduction, that is a oogamous type. That is means two different types of gametes are present over there, that is gametes are formed in the Anthridium and Archegonium. Anthridia and Archegonia are multicellular with sterile jacket wall. So come towards the Anthridium. Anthridia is having a club shaped and stalked structure. So this is the complete club shaped structure and that having a stalk. They originate on apex of the Anthridial branch. So the single Funaria plant also get develops new branches, and on that branches there is a development of an Anthridial branch. That Anthridial branch having a Anthridia. Between Anthridia, paraphases are present which are multicellular leaves. So these are the paraphases which are as like leaves, and they are giving protection to the whatever present inside. On Anthridial branch, Anthridia offer different developmental stages can be seen. Each Anthridium has two parts, that is basal portion called as a stalk, which is a multicellular, and the body with sterile jackets. Then the presence of a chloroplast in jacket cell are also seen. At the apex of the jacket, colorless one or two opercular cells are present. These are called as carp cell, through which biflagellates and colloid anthrozoids emerge out. This body contains a mass of androcytes. So this is the complete structure of Anthridium, which has possessed basal stalk. This is the club shaped androcytes, and these are the jacket cells. At the apex, this jacket cell having a transfer colored cells which are called as a carp cell. They are having a opercular cells, and from that location there is a emergence out there is a point for the emergence, or that can be split into two different halves, and the biflagellate colloid anthrozoids can be liberated from this location. Then the Archegonia, which originates on archegonial lateral branch. Between Archegonia, decapitated paraphases are present. On archegonial branch, different developmental stages of Archegonia can be seen, that have Archegonia is like a flask shape. It has two parts, solon winter. So this one is the bulk like or solon part called as a winter, and the narrow part, which is a twisted neck composed of six vertical row of cells called as a neck. At the apex of the neck, two lead cells are found, which are called as a cover cell. Venter, having one venter canal cell, so this one is the venter canal cell, and one large oospore called as a egg cell. And next, having a vertical arrangement of six neck canal cells. So this is the complete structure of an archegonium, which having a large bulk like venter. So this one is the venter, which get protected in a neck canal cell. This is the largest cell, which is called as a oospore or egg cell. Above that there is a presence of a venter canal cell, and above that there is a just presence of a six neck canal cell. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 neck canal cell that also get protected with the help of jacket cells. So all of these are nothing but an a jacket cell. And at the apex of a neck, there is a presence of a two cover cells. So in this way, they have possessed their own structural arrangement. Then come towards fertilization. Water is essential for the fertilization. Anthrozoids swim towards the archegonia by chemotaxis. Chemotaxis is due to the attraction of a sugar chemicals which are released by the archegonia. Anthrozoids and eggs, when get unites, at that time there is a development of a zygote, which is a oospore, is first cell of a sporophytic generation. Sporophyte has three parts. First of all, basal, that is a foot, which is a conical shape that can absorb water and minerals for the sporophyte. Then cytha is a long twisted structure, stem like, that can convey mineral and water up towards the capsule and helps in the spore dispersal. So the capsule is a pear shaped body. It has following parts, that is apophysis. Apophysis has possesses basal solid green part. Its epidermis contains stomata. Inner cell of apophysis contain chloroplast, and also it contains central conducting strand, which is connected to conducting strand of cytha. Later on, it also has a main part called as a theca. Theca is nothing but an a main part of a capsule where spores are formed. Structure of a theca is just like a capsule, which is a multilayered, that also have air chambers. Within that air chambers, which present at inner to the capsule wall and surrounding the spore sac, a large air chamber is present, which perceived by uniseriate or one cell thick chlorenchymatous thread or a trabeculae. The spore sac, it surrounds the sterile central part of the capsule called as a columella. Spore sac contains spore mother cell, which undergoes meiosis to form four haploid spores. Columella, which is central solid sterile part, it provides nutrition and water for developing spores. So this is the complete structure of a capsule, which has cytha, which is a basal portion. This is the central conducting strand, which can supply water, minerals and foods. This epidermis of a capsule has gate interrupted by the stomata. Then this one is the inner wall of a spore sac. So this one is the spore sac and these are the wall layers. These are the spores. Then they have an outer wall also. These and above the outer wall or at the peripheral side of the outer wall of the spore sac, there is a presence of an air chamber. So all are these the air chambers, and that has divided by the trabeculae. And at the periphery of a trabeculae, there is a presence of a cortex. This cortex also has above it or at the periphery, there is a presence of a hypodermis, and above the hypodermis, there is a presence of a epidermis, and at the center, there is a presence of a columella. These are the rheims, annules, and peristomes which can protect the spore sac at the apical region. So finally, this capsule has an apophyse, means a basal portion, which is a seta and conducting strand. Then a theca, which is a thick layer of epidermis, hypodermis, cortex, trabeculae, and air chamber. And at the center, there is a presence of a operculum, which is the main part having a spore sac. So operculum has a lid of a capsule which is composed of a 4 to 5 layers of the cells. After maturity of a capsule, it is removed. So this one is the operculum, which has developed by the rheim, annules, and peristome. Then peristome, below the operculum, it bears two rows of a conical thick peristomal teeth. Each row bears 16 teeth. These teeth of peristome close the spore sac at apex. Teeth are hygroscopic, which liberate spores during drought. Then annules, these are present below the basal part of a operculum. This is the ring of epidermal cells which are present, but due to the breaking of annules, operculum get removed. Here is also the presence of a calyptra. This is due to the development of a sporophyte archegonium. It split into two lower half parts, surrounds the foot. Upper half part forms membranous cap which covers capsule apex, called as a calyptra. At the time of a dehiscence of a capsule, there is a dispersal of a spores that can help by the peristomal teeth. In dry period, annules ruptured and operculum get removed. In a dry condition, peristomal teeth move upwards, and in moisture move toward downwards. So due to this movement, the teeth spores release from capsule due to the upward displacement, and the spore first cell of a gametophyte, which is rounded, bear outer and inner wall that containing fat droplets and chloroplasts. During favorable condition, that spores germinate and form branch thread called as a protonema. On protonema, there is a development of rhizoids and buds get originate. Bud develops into the plant of a funaria. So this is the complete life cycle of a plant funaria. This is the funaria. This one is the male shoot. This one is the female shoot. Male shoot can bears or develop anthridia, and female shoot can be developed archegonia. Here is the antheridia in a cross-sectional view. This is the complete structure of an antheridia which can liberate antherozoids. This is the archegonia. This one is the complete developed archegonium, and this archegonium can be ruptured and these antheridia are going to be fused with a egg cell or oospore. At last the oospore get fertilized by the antherozoids and there is a development of an embryo. That embryo again develop into an embryo sporophyte. This was the young sporophyte which showing a calyptra foot seta structure, and here is the complete development of a capsule. Within a capsule there is a development of a spores, and that is developed by the spore tetrad. Spore mother, first of all there is a spore mother cell that can be redivide, and the spore tetrad gets forms that can be again develop into a spores. That spores directly germinate into a new plant, and that capsule has liberate that spores. That spores expose into a germ tube, and then there is a development of a protonema. Protonema has a buds. That buds again develop into a young gametophyte of a funaria. This is all about a gametophytic generation and sporophytic generation. So this one is the sporophytic generation, this one is the gametophytic generation, and this is all about a funaria life cycle. So thank you for watching my lecture.